Good morning and welcome to Lakeshore St. Andrews, coming to you today from the beautiful Jasper National Park along the Athabasca River. Today is January 31st and here are some announcements.
Have you ever wanted to keep the conversation going after the Sunday service, whatever the sermon topic is about? You just want to discuss it a little bit more, a little more in depth. Or maybe you want to take that Sunday challenge and you want to talk about it with somebody or just maybe have somebody encourage you to do it. Well, LSA has got three new environments for you to do just that. We're going to have a men's group, a ladies group, and an open group. And that's going to start in February. So if you're already working with a small group and you would like to try something like this, all you have to do is get in touch with me and I'll give you those questions.
If you have any questions or need more information, check out our website, our Facebook page, or catch me at the office. I'm Sharon. Now let's continue with our service.
Good morning and welcome to Lakeshore St. Andrews. We're so glad you've joined us online. And we're just going to start this service with some songs and focus our minds and hearts on the God of the universe that gives us life, that gives us abundant life through Christ. And one of the ways we do that is with music. So we're going to just focus in on him and give him our praise. He's worthy.
Of time, he who made every living thing, behold him. He who heard humanity's cry, left his throne to wake as a child, he became like the least of us, behold him.
Still.
Sing your praise.
For all the ways that you have cared for us, carried us, even when we didn't know you were there, maybe when we didn't believe in you or didn't believe you could do amazing things, God, you have been faithful to each one of us because we're here and we're drawing to you. And so thank you for all the ways that you've done that. And we know you do so much more. Open our eyes to the ways that you have your hand in our lives and that you carry us through. You put people in our lives. You surround us with your love. You surround us with prayers. Help us to see it and believe for this and greater things. And for to believe for these things for others as well, that we pray over them, that you will continue to be faithful and good, and that we will see it and we will thank you every day and always. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Kids Cove in Big Church. We have an object lesson for you today to help you better understand Pastor Brian's message from Titus 1, 7 to 9. But before we do that, I want to remind you to make sure you check out our LSA Kids Cove Facebook page for more activities and lessons throughout the week. Take it away, Megan.
All right, so there comes a time in every Christian's life where hopefully they're going to get the opportunity to share the gospel with somebody. Now, if you're trying to share the gospel and you're trying to teach about Jesus' love, but your actions aren't lining up with that, you're probably not going to make that much of an impact. Just like this empty rope. Not much of an impact. Whereas, if you put weight behind your words and your actions match up with what you're teaching or preaching, it's going to have a greater impact.
And that's like our bottom line for today. Practice what you preach. All right, let's pray. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to be up here and sharing your word, Lord God. And I pray that you be with Pastor Brian as he preaches today. I pray that we can all receive this message, Lord God. We love you. We thank you for all that you do. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, Lakeshore St. Andrews. It's so good to be with you again this morning studying God's Word. We're in our fourth week of an eight-week series entitled Unfinished, where we're looking at the book of Titus. We're in chapter 1 of Titus. We're looking at verses 5 to 9, and the title of our sermon this morning is Who Should Lead the Church? Part 2. So let's dive right into the text. The text is Titus chapter 1, verses 5 to 9. The reason I left you in Crete was that you might put in order what was left unfinished and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. An elder must be blameless, faithful to his wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer manages God's household, he must be blameless. Not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for the elders that you have given us here at Lakeshore St. Andrews. Lord, we pray that we would all hold to a high standard of lifestyle and that we would encourage one another in these good things. Lord, we pray that we would also raise up other elders, keeping them all accountable to your good word, to your message to us. Lord, just be with us now as we open and dig into your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So many of you have probably followed a speaker, pastor, evangelist, apologist at some time in your life. You followed them, you watched them on YouTube, got their DVDs, read their books. You just engaged with the material that they were putting out. I've done the very same thing. I've followed a couple speakers very closely over the years. One of them was named Bill Hybels. The other is Ravi Zacharias, and they were really good. Bill Hybels was excellent at helping me think about reaching the lost, reaching the community. So he would talk about things like seeker-sensitive service. He would talk about things like small groups and how we need to grow small groups. Ravi Zacharias helped with social issues. So when I didn't know how to respond to somebody and what they said, I would go to Ravi, and Ravi would have this biblical answer for some social issue or social problem. So I really appreciated everything that they had to offer. But things got a little weird over the last couple years because these two individuals, great biblical teachers, had some breakdown in their character. And so Bill Hybels had some indiscretions that really took him out of the limelight and out of the Christian world. Ravi Zacharias, you know, who has since passed away, but we're learning had some abusive actions in his past. And this has made it tough for me to still enjoy and engage with their material. I want to. I can see the truth of what they have to say there. But there's this little thing in my mind where I'm putting an asterisk beside what they're saying and really questioning it. And the reason is because what someone says should match up with what they do. And when it doesn't, trust breaks down. And so I'm not for cancel culture or trying to remove somebody out of having anything valuable to say or any contribution simply because of a mistake. However, when there's consistent mistakes in their life and a continual lifestyle like that that opposes what they teach, I'm starting to question all the different things they teach. What they taught could have been good, but when it doesn't line up, you can't go without always questioning now everything that's being said. And that doesn't feel so good to have somebody, you're watching somebody who's talking about personal morality, and yet you know that they have fallen apart in their own moral life. Or somebody that talks about, you know, the importance of reaching the lost, but is engaging in behavior that wouldn't line up with what Jesus Christ, the essence of what we're proclaiming to everybody else, would want someone to be doing. I think there's this great quote out there that says it takes 20 years to build a great reputation, something that Hybels and Zacharias really did, but it only takes 5 minutes to destroy that character. And here's the thing, I think that goes even more so in our day and age. In our day and age of the internet age, people are watching what you do on social media. People are watching what you do at the grocery store. People are watching you all the time. And you've got a message as a believer. Just by saying you're a Christian, you're proclaiming a message. And the question people ask over and over again is, does your message and do your actions align? And as they don't align, as there's misalignment, there's a drop in trust. As they see alignment, there is a trust, and people want to hear what we have to say. So we have to be very careful that our lives cross over, that there is a definite connection between what we say and what we do. Now let's get a bit of context for our sermon this morning. You see, elders are the people that are supposed to have the most amount of alignment. There should be the greatest alignment in our elders, maybe more than anybody else in our church. And that's why we call them to lead us. And Paul's going to get to that. But in verses 1 and 2, remember, he talks about the importance of his mission. And his mission, and I think a mission that we would connect with, is that of being a servant. He just wants to serve God. And his motivation is the hope of eternal life. Now, what he's done is he's left Titus on Crete to finish up some important work. You see, this church in Crete is just at the fledgling stage. It's gone through some wonderful revival. Some good things are happening, but they haven't organized very well to accomplish God's mission. They're unfinished. And so Paul says, look, I'm leaving you, Titus, in Crete to finish up some of these important works, to get things organized. And the key to that, the key to doing God's work and organizing, is appointing elders, appointing the right group of people. Now remember from last week, elders are really important to Presbyterians. That's how we organize our church. And we call our elders, as it biblically states we should, to a high standard. Now that high standard is first in their home, but is second in their public life, the way they operate in the church and the way they operate out in the world. So let's take a look this morning a little bit at these different characteristics we're going to expect in elders, but we're also going to want to see in ourselves. So we're looking for alignment in elders, maybe at their very best, but this goes for all people, you and me included, into how we should also be living our lives. So looking at verse 7. Verse 7 points out that an overseer should manage God's household and must be blameless. And we're seeing this new word, overseer. Now, overseer and elder are basically the same term. They could be used in different ways. One way, elder is really more of a title, and overseer is more of the action. So it's not talking of a different person, same person, just one's a title and one's an action. And an overseer manages God's household. Notice this important thing. He or she simply manages God's household. It's a simple task. It's somewhere we don't have to do anything big. We just have to take care of what's already here. Now, what kind of manager is he or is she? They are the overseer, and they manage God's household. So they are a household manager. In fact, that's the translation of the Greek word oikonomos. Oikonomos is a Greek word that means a servant that was trusted by a homeowner where they could leave all of their material, all of their finances, their human resources, and all the work to be done to that manager, and that manager would do it, would take it. So they are an overseer, manages God's household, is an oikonomos. Now, while elders are really important, elders are essential, we have to remember that they are simply managers. Elders or pastors are not kingdom builders. This is a mistake we see in the church often, that pastors or leaders of churches will talk about building God's kingdom. The reality is, we aren't to build God's kingdom. We're just supposed to manage the household. God is the kingdom builder. God is the one who accomplishes all these wonderful, great things, expansive kingdom things. What we're supposed to do is manage our little piece, our little corner. We're supposed to take care of it. Now, when we manage it well, it will grow. You know, if you give money into a management fund, they are going to take care of the money, and the expectation is you're going to get some sort of return. And so the same thing here. God expects a return, but not based on us building a kingdom, but on managing what he gives us and managing it well. Now, this is still a high calling because the house is great, because the house owner is great, because God is great. What we do as managers is also very important. So let's look a little bit at these qualities. The first quality that we notice is one I haven't highlighted here, but it's the word blameless. Now, there's a repetition here. Remember, we said that elders needed to be blameless in verse 6. So the repetition is highlighting how essential this is, this blamelessness that we should see in an elder, that they shouldn't have any major moral failure in their lives, that they shouldn't be living in a sinful pattern based on scriptural standards today. Now, what does that blamelessness entail? That's the really big question. What does blamelessness look like? Well, that's what the point of this little hyphen here is. The point of the hyphen is to say, look, what blamelessness is going to be defined now. I'm going to give you a list of all the things that make up blamelessness. And what he's going to show us are five vices and seven virtues that make up someone who should be a blameless elder. The first one is one we've got highlighted here. It's not overbearing. Not overbearing. Overbearing people are those that really don't care about other people. People are just a means to an end. So they've got this goal in mind, and it's a very personal, self-centered goal, and they use people to accomplish what they want. And they don't mind running over people. They don't mind doing whatever is needed to get what they want, their personal vision, their personal goal. Now, sometimes people will hide behind being what they'll call biblical leaders and just, well, I'm just a strong leader. But the way you'll notice that they're overbearing is that not only on biblical issues will they stand strong, but even on issues that don't matter so much, they're still pushing their own personal agenda. So whether it's the color of the carpet or what kind of light bulbs we use, they're still pushing people and trying to get their agenda to be accomplished. They're not willing to back off. They're overbearing. She's not going to be quick-tempered. Quick-tempered is something that we see in younger people. I know when I was a young man, I had a bit more of a temper. I'd lose my temper more easily. Now, as you grow up, you learn to manage that a little better. Because the reality is, it's not helpful in life. It's not helpful at your job. It's not helpful in your sports team. Now, maybe if you were a 4th century berserker in the Viking Age, having a quick temper would have helped. But almost nowhere else in the world today does that quick temper help, especially in the church, especially as an elder. Elders in the past that I've seen, or even church members, use anger usually as a tool or as a club to intimidate people and to get what they want. And here's the strange thing. People often make excuses for them and say, well, that's just the way that Joe is. That's just the way Brian is. But we shouldn't make excuses for these things. We should change. We should be transformed by Jesus Christ. Now, the next one is not given to drunkenness and not violent. Now, this is actually a word pair that go together. And it's something that we know through experience, right? Violence and drunkenness go together. If you are a drunk, or you know a drunk, or you've been severely intoxicated at times, you know that violence is something that is easier to come about in your life. And that these two things, alcohol and violence, go together. Now, while we know about this from a common sense perspective, we also know from studies that this is true. The most people that commit violent crime and that are incarcerated have actually done what they did under the influence of alcohol. We know that much of the domestic violence we see, drunk driving, so a lot of accidents. Again, it comes through alcohol. Alcohol is a precursor to a lot of the other things, the vices that we see. But violence not only is something connected to alcohol, it's also something that we see at a lower level in the church. I don't think we see violence and alcohol in the church very often, but we do see a low-level kind of violence called bullying. Bullying is something where you use kind of maybe if you're really smart, your mind, or if you're really tall, or maybe you're really big, or maybe you have that short temper, you use this as a type of intimidation to get your way. You pressure people through this bullying tactic. You don't use reason or influence. You just use pressure and try to get your way. And here's the thing. In the church at Lakeshore St. Andrews, there's no place for that. There's no place for that. What we offer here is a safe place for people to engage and deal with the temptations and challenges they have, not to come in and to use them in the church for their own gain. We're not for that. Now, the next one is the church, an elder, and anybody in the church, shouldn't be using the church for the pursuit of dishonest gain. Now, the reason that Paul has this one in is because the men and women of Crete were known for pursuing money at all costs. They would give up reputation. They would give up their church relationships. They would give up family. They would give up anything to make some sort of financial gain. Now, Paul's not against wealth. He's not against working hard and making money. But he is against you pursuing it at the expense of everything else. He says, put your life properly in order. And pursuing wealth shouldn't be number one, shouldn't even be number two. You know, we're thinking of God, we're thinking of family, we're thinking of church. These should take priority over making money. Making money is important, but it just needs to be prioritized correctly. Now, again, the men and women of Crete, they weren't prioritizing it correctly. They had it as number one. So even in the church, they were trying to find ways to take money from other church members, to swindle people, and they thought it was okay. And so he says, look, you can't be doing that. The church is not the place for making this kind of financial gain. So that's the list of vices. Then we move to verse 8, which talks about the virtues that we should see in any Christian, but particularly, again, in an elder. An elder first should be hospitable. Now, our whole church, of course, should be hospitable. We should be welcoming people here into this building. We should be welcoming people into our homes. I think the whole problem and the whole challenge we've had with COVID is we haven't been able to have people into our homes. This virtue that we've had grow in us because of what Christ has done in us, we haven't been able to use. Now, we've done the best we can. We have videos, we have Zoom, we have the different meeting apps, and we've tried that. We've phoned people, we're on video, but there's just something different about seeing somebody face to face rather than over video. So we've got this virtue we want to develop, hospitality, but COVID's been holding us back from being able to do that. And I don't know about you, but I am so ready for COVID to be over. I'm so ready for the limitations to be over. I want nobody to ask anymore about who I had over to my home or when they came or how many people were there. Won't it be so strange to not have any of those limitations anymore and just be able to go wherever you want, whenever you want, with whoever you want? It's going to be kind of a strange thing when it first opens up. So this idea of hospitality is something that should be most evident in an elder's life. Now, they are also to love what is good. Now, this isn't a philosophical love what is good, like, oh, I love the idea of truth, or I love the idea of respect, or I love the idea of caring for other people. Rather, this is something that has hands and feet, as it were. You don't just think about the good. You don't just love the good. You embody the good. So if you love the truth, you tell the truth. That's what it means. If you love respect, you think respect is a great thing as an idea, if you really love it, you're going to actually live it out as well. You're going to respect people. So the question that we all have to ask ourselves is, how am I embodying these really good things that I believe are scriptural, that are good, and that are important? The next one is, they are to be, and Christians are to be, self-controlled. Now, in ancient times, in the time of Plato and Aristotle, this virtue was the most important one. This would have been the one at the top. So the people Paul is talking to, like Titus, but other people as well, would have understood this virtue as being very important. In fact, all the vices that we've talked about that people have to deal with are usually dealt with by having self-control. By having self-control, you deal with a number of the other problems that might come up. Now, the Cretans, though, this wasn't an obvious virtue to them. They actually seemed many times to be out of control to the culture around them. But for us as elders, this can't ever be the case. I don't think it should be the case for any Christian. Self-control is really important. Out of control is just not helpful. Especially when you go think about people that are online that aren't self-controlled and just post random things or maybe say something, offhand remark, and they hurt people on a regular basis. This is something that we've got to avoid. And really, elders shouldn't do this, should be the best at being self-controlled and not letting those remarks jump off or jump out of their mouth and hurt other people. They need to be self-controlled. The next two are upright and holy. Upright and holy are a word pair, like drunkenness and violence are a word pair. The two of them go together. Now, holiness just means set apart unto God. A holy place is a place that's been set apart unto God. A holy person is one that has set their lives apart unto God. Because of what Jesus has done for us, he's bought us, he's paid for us, we are his, we are now, in virtue of that, we are now holy. We have been set apart, and we are supposed to live that out in practical action. Living it out in practical action is called uprightness. That I live by justice, that I live by truth, that I live fairly with other people. And this must most clearly be in the life of elders. To me, these two might be the two of the most important ones. Here's the thing. An elder should never treat a wealthy person or a poor person differently. So they should be holy, set apart for God's work, embodying the good things. And then when they live them out, they should treat these people fairly. They should treat these people with respect. Doesn't matter where they come from or what their financial background is. In a similar way, when it comes to whether you're black, white, or brown, or whatever color you are, the elders should be colorblind when it comes to that. They shouldn't worry about where you come from. They treat everybody fairly. They treat people biblically. They treat people as if they are brothers and sisters in Christ with no difference. This is to treat them with uprightness. Now, the last quality that we're going to look at is disciplined. Disciplined. Have you ever wanted to come first in some sporting event? Have you ever wanted to make that all-star team? Have you ever wanted to ace an exam? Well, if you have and you've worked at it, you know that it takes discipline to accomplish it. It takes a lot of work. It's not easy. It takes study, it takes energy, it takes time, and you have to be really dedicated to do it even when you don't feel like it. When we look at Olympic athletes, we see this all the time. We see athletes who have dedicated hours, 10,000, 20,000 hours of time. You know, when everyone else was still sleeping, they were waking up early and training. When other people were off with their friends, they were studying. The same thing goes when we think of elders. Elders are like Olympic athletes. They are people who dedicate themselves to God, studying his word, praying, meditating on his word, memorizing his word, engaging with it every day. They are also people that will go out and visit people when it's not convenient or care for people when it really doesn't fit into their schedule. These are people who are disciplined, that are willing to do things for a greater good, even when it's not easy. And all of this leads to now what we come to is verse 9. All of the virtues that we've talked about, all the vices, whether in family and public, have all been leading to this verse. Verse 5 to verse 8 all lead to verse 9. All of these virtues are required. All of these qualities are needed so that they can teach and their teaching can have impact. As our object lesson taught us, that if we're going to have impact in the world today, if we're going to have impact, then our words must match our actions. What we preach, we must practice. This is so essential for an elder. So they have to have the character qualities first. So when they preach, we'll see alignment between the two. And so the characteristics that we've been leading up to verse 9 are all for the practice of teaching, to help them get ready to do this really most important work. Now, elders are called to lots of other things like administration and care, but those are all secondary towards teaching, teaching the biblical truth. Now, the first thing we read here is that they have to hold firmly to this trustworthy message. The Bible is not about all sorts of new revelations. You know, the Bible doesn't have new books being added to it. It doesn't have new other things being changed within the words themselves. Rather, the Bible is established. The message of God has been given, and it is the elder's job to hold firmly to that, to this all-sufficient word of God that gives us direction on how to be the church, but also how to live life. Now, we are to use this word that we hold firmly to encourage others. We use it to encourage others. It's not just something that we study and just do some academic work. We're supposed to, especially elders, but everyone is supposed to use what we learn to encourage others. Now, some people think encouraging others means making it relevant or making it easy or watering it down. I'm going to tell you this. You don't encourage people by watering the Word of God down. You want to encourage them, you have to give it to them full strength. You have to give it to them full strength and allow the Holy Spirit to work in their lives and help grow them in this. You see, even in an elder's life, we need to come to the Word of God and we need to wrestle with it. We can't wrestle with something that isn't given to us full strength, straight up. We need to give it so that now we're challenged to grow. We wrestle with it, we disagree with it, we challenge it, and we continue to study it. And as we do, God grows us up to the level of Scripture, that wonderful truth it's teaching. Now, here's the thing. While we're doing that, while we're struggling with it, that's okay. But we still need to, and elders most specifically need to submit to it. We're submitting to it even while we don't fully understand it. We don't fully agree with it necessarily. So elders live out this submission, and as they do, I think they are able to, are given, have the qualities required to act as our guardians of the faith, protecting us and discerning the way forward for our church and our community. Now, when people oppose it, people oppose the Bible and oppose biblical truth, our elders are there, those that have been studying that word, are there to encourage us, yes, but also refute those who are teaching something that is wrong, teaching something that you wouldn't find in the Scriptures. So the elders can never be lax. They can never be idle. They can never be lazy. They always have to be searching and looking throughout the church to find out where some of these wrong positions on the Scriptures or these wrong ideas are kind of filtering in the church, and then present biblical answers to them. They have to be really good at recognizing false teaching. Now, refuting people does not mean, refuting is not refuting people, it's refuting ideas. They're not angry at people, they're not against people, they're against the ideas that people are bringing. An elder is always for people. They're always for the salvation of those people because God loves them. God loves the elder and God loves those people no matter who they are. And so we never think of ourselves as being in a battle against that other person. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, as Paul says. It's against the powers and the principalities of this dark world. It's against something you can't see. And so we are battling those things, not the people. And for that reason, we have to be very careful. And this is maybe why the virtues are so important as well, is that when we're engaging with people that are fighting against us, this is the time when we most clearly need to live in a way that isn't quick to anger. We have to live in a way that is hospitable and loving and generous, not seeking our own gain, not trying to push people over, but rather listening and hearing and engaging with them in a loving way that hopefully will convince them of the truth of Scripture and the truth of God. So friends, we have been called to the front lines. I think LSA has been called to stand in these challenging times as a light to our community. Now, because we're a light to the community, we are going to be under great temptation to follow many different paths. We have to be very clear about where God wants to call us. And so for such a time as this, we need great elders. And we need to hold them accountable to being the kind of leaders that we are going to follow. Elders are going to lead the way. They're going to lead the way, and their lives and your life and my life need to coincide with this truth that we're proclaiming, so that no one anywhere will ever have a reason to see our message as being compromised. Rather, they would look at LSA and they would say, what a wonderful truth they share, and how wonderful it is that their actions align with what they say. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your work here with us. Lord, that you're helping to bring our actions in alignment with the truth we proclaim. Be with us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We pray.
So I want to challenge you here this morning to bring your actions in alignment with what you believe about Jesus Christ. You say you believe, and that is wonderful. But the question people are going to have is, what difference does that make in your life? How have you changed? So I want to encourage you, bring those vices that you have, bring them to God that he may free you from them. And also bring your virtues to God that he may grow you in them. Amen.
Shake the ground with the sound of revival.